part six in a series called How Good Is Your Doc? And as you begin to see in this series, it's not often how good is your doc, it's more often how good is your doc's backup team, and that backup team includes you. So what I'm doing in this series is showing you that yes, there is significant difference in performance with docs, but again, start thinking yourself as a doctor-patient team. By far, the best patient is a well-informed patient. I'm going to get into another area, and yes, some of it gets ugly. Unfortunately, when you let disease go, it gets ugly. Now, congestive heart failure, I got this off of Pinterest. It's an interesting little image, and it goes into a lot of the details on a med school student approach to congestive heart failure. Dilated pupils because the heart's having to thump hard, work hard to keep up, and so your sympathetic system's going. Decreased blood pressure because, again, your heart's not it's not got good output. It's not putting out as much as it would like. You get ascites. You get what's called edema, dependent appearing edema. Now, what is that? That's this. And why does that happen? Again, the blood begins to pool up in your legs and your lungs and your belly because your heart is failing. It's not getting that blood out of there. Now, what's the most common cause? Stiffness of the ventricle due to 30 years of neglected high blood pressure, or multiple micro infarcts. And you remember what causes those? Tiny little clots, microscopic clots. And you remember what causes those? Cardiovascular inflammation. And I skipped a couple of steps there. The clots are caused by tiny little microscopic droplets of inflamed plaque that go into the blood and form tiny little clots. If they form a big one, that's a heart attack or a stroke. Now, how common is it? Much more common than you would guess. Here's this one, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. This is the sixth area, shows again the difference between the docs in the green bar that tend to get the hemoglobin A1Cs, educate their patients, look for heart failure, look for cancers, look for vascular diseases. The docs in the green are the guys that are focusing. They're obsessive compulsive. But here's the thing. Now, so you begin to see, okay, maybe being obsessive compulsive helps my doc find occult or unrecognized or asymptomatic disease. But it's not just the docs. The docs don't, if the doc is a solo practitioner without a backup team, he or she's not getting this kind of information on a regular basis. So it doesn't matter whether they went to Hopkins or Harvard or any of the big places if they don't have a good backup team, at least in terms of some of these preventive programs. So for your primary care doc and for your personal doctor team, I would suggest that you maybe think about a large organization. Those large organizations have the facilities, the resources to develop a backup team, which holds in front of the doc. Okay, you know what? I'm missing heart failure, or I'm missing vascular disease. And we've covered vascular disease, diabetes, malnutrition, lung disease already. So again, it's all about looking for asymptomatic disease. If you're just waiting till the disease hits you in the face, you're looking at the tip of the iceberg. Now, we're going to see some images of some upside-down hearts for a few minutes. Again, this helps you understand what structural heart disease is. And on the left here, you see a what's called a cardiac ultrasound or a carotid Doppler. Basically, what it's doing is it's the same technology that you've seen in the movies where a submarine is using ultrasound to ping off to see if there are other submarines in the area or ships. Or if you have a bass finder, a fish finder on your boat, it's the same technology. So what we're doing here, though, is looking at the structure of the heart. Right ventricle, RV, left ventricle, LV. And as you see here, the left ventricle has significantly thicker muscle tissue. The reason for that is it has to push against the resistance of the entire body. The right heart or right ventricle, which is on the left-hand side because we're flipped over, the right ventricle does not need as much strength to pump to the lungs. Now, what are some of the reasons that we miss it? Again, that big tip of the iceberg issue. It's if it's asymptomatic and your doc is not digging, then he's waiting for it to hit him in the face. The vast majority of heart failure is mild and unrecognized, asymptomatic. It doesn't even decrease your ability to exercise. We'll go over in a few minutes the New York stratification for heart failure, the staging for heart failure, and you'll see the first stage has no symptoms, has no decrease in function at all. Now, when we say diastolic counts, what we're talking about is diastolic heart failure. And I will go over that as we talk a little bit deeper about the structure. Some of this is going to get a little bit complicated, maybe a little bit geeky for the medical side. E to A ratio. I'm not going to get too deep into that. I will do some brief ejection fraction statements. Now, what is there's got to be a test, right? Yes, and yes, it is the one that we've already talked about. It's a cardiac ultrasound or a Doppler. And am I saying that your doc should do one of these on everybody? Actually, I don't do a whole lot. And here's the reason. We already have a lot of information regarding the patient. Usually, CIMT, inflammatory panel, and glucose tolerance test, insulin survey, give us much deeper information. So we begin to understand what's going on with the patient and their issues at that point. If we manage those, most of these are going to take care of themselves. Manage that and the blood pressure. Speaking of blood pressure, what's the most common cause of this problem? Impaired wall motion and stiffness. What does that mean? Hypertrophy. A thicker wall. We'll talk about that in just a second. And again, dysfunction versus failure versus... Here we're going to talk about dysfunction. So if you took that heart and you cut it sideways like that instead of this way, horizontally, you would see this. This is the left ventricle with this thick wall, and then the right ventricle over here with the thinner wall. Now, if you go for decades with high blood pressure and that left ventricle having to push harder than it should against arteries that are clamped up with high blood pressure, then you're going to get hypertrophy of this wall, this muscle. What happens if that occurs? You get less volume inside that muscle. So the atria will push to try to fill up that ventricle. The major force for filling the ventricle actually is the suck from the ventricle relaxing. And again, if that wall is hypertrophied, there's not enough space for it to create a good suck to pull blood in. Therefore, the ejection fraction, the amount of blood that's pushed out, is less. And that's what starts a major start to the congestive heart failure process. Now, so yes, cardiac ultrasound is very helpful, especially if you have some reasons to be screening for this early on and you already know the situation in terms of cardiovascular inflammation. Now, just to go through some of the items on here. This is a rundown of the types of heart failure. The ICD-9's heart failure is just basically unspecified cardiomyopathy, which again is problems with the heart, the muscle itself. Used to be one of the more common types of cardiomyopathy was alcoholic cardiomyopathy. As I've said before, by far the most common problem is decades of hypertension. Having had an old heart attack can cause this problem as well. In fact, my father died with congestive heart failure. He was in this kind of shape and worse in terms of his in terms of what was going on with him. He was in this kind of shape and worse. He was actually, when he exhaled, foam was coming out of his mouth. And again, it was because he had a heart attack. And that heart attack blew away a large portion of the muscle that in the ventricle that was supplying the push force. Again, after chronic hypertension, having had one or multiple damaged areas in your ventricle due to heart attack is, I think, the second most common problem here. My dad, we knew what was the causative agent. Again, we always want to start looking at root causes. He was north of 350 pounds many times in his life, and most of the time was about 350 pounds. So the same things that protect you from cardiovascular inflammation often tend to protect you from congestive heart failure as well. Thank you very much for your interest.